Genside. Welcome to church. I hope you like to sing. I like to sing wherever I go.
All my life, all I know, God's been good, good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my life, thou hast taught me to say. My sin, know the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear. Praise the Lord.
I'm here this morning in Lindsay, Ontario, with Pastor Mike Kleinhaus from the Centre Community Church. The Centre Community Church is one of a couple of Feb Central church plants that we partner with, and we're excited to be here with you today, Mike.
I'm glad to meet with you. This is good.
Good. So how old is the Centre?
So we just celebrated our fifth anniversary back in January, right in the middle of a lockdown, so that wasn't fun.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. My family moved up in summer of 2015, and so we have been here just over 5.5 years. And yeah, I can't believe how fast the time has gone. It really has flown by.
Well, Mike, I'm gonna hit you with a question that I'm sure you didn't see coming, but this past year, there's been something going on, and how has COVID affected your ministry?
Oh, it hasn't at all. It has really reshaped how we do things for everybody. It's really been life changing. So we have had to do more of this. So we're online as well. Most of our ministries were shut down. We couldn't do them. Because things happened. But out of it, we've also seen some kind of cool things that have taken place. Mm. One thing that has happened is last summer, as soon as the parks opened up, we started meeting outside. And we had an outdoor service of every Sunday from the end of July right up until the end of September, which was really cool. But as I was saying, like most of the ministry that we were doing beforehand, barbecues, outreach, they ground to a halt, and we couldn't do them. So that was frustrating. So we've gone online. We've done a lot of our gatherings right when things shut down. We went online, and progressively got better. It's a learning curve. I don't like technology. But I'm thankful for it, and I'm thankful for the blessing that it is. Also, with some of our ministries towards the school, we did a lot of partnering with King Albert Public School beforehand, and that stopped. And so we had to readjust that, which was, a little bit of a work in progress as well.
Mm. So you couldn't do the same ministry in the school. Were there other agencies, partners that you usually worked with that you couldn't work with anymore?
Yeah, so the funny thing about it was that because of COVID, we were actually able to do more with the local United Way. If you've ever gone through the South End and gone past the Crayola factory, the old Crayola factory, there's a great big community garden there, the Edwin Binney Memorial Garden. And the United Way has produced thousands of pounds of food over the last couple summers, and each summer getting more and more. And they were looking for a partner that could distribute food into the neighborhood. And so they contacted us. And so through the summer months last year, when they were producing and harvesting food, we'd fill up the back of my van, and I'd go around to families in the neighborhood and open up the back, and they would come and get fresh produce. And so that was one way in which we were able to partner with the local agency, bless the people of the community, and provide for a need that is there that was really tangible. And in the midst of doing that, share the love and the hope and of joy of Jesus Christ. Mm. And so it was really, really good. although we haven't been able to do the soup at King Albert, which I miss, honestly, it was fun. Every Friday through the school year, we would make soup and we would provide soup for the whole school, for all the staff. After school was done, we would have bags of soup left over that we would give out to families. But because of COVID, we can't be in the school. And so we still partner with the school in reaching those families that struggle with food security. So the school has directed us towards some families, and the families have reached out to us, and we've been able to help with groceries. Thanksgiving, we did hampers up for the first time. And we're gonna be doing that for Easter as well, where we'll provide a food hamper for families that are in need. And at Christmas time, we have in years past done Christmas hampers. This year it expanded. We went from about 20 up to 30, and the need has just grown. It really has grown. And so we were able to help more families because of COVID. As much as it has disrupted us, it still has been a blessing as well. Mm. And so, yeah, we thank God for these opportunities that He's given us.
That's incredible. Your ministry, the way you minister to these people has changed. Mm-hmm. Now, did your mission and vision change?
Absolutely not. No, our mission and vision is to reach the south end of Lindsay, to be a light, to share the hope and the love of Jesus Christ to the south end, and to see lives transformed because of the salvation that comes through Christ. So that hasn't changed, and that will remain our focus. Even though we're online, even though we're meeting people further afield, our focus is still to be a neighborhood church to the south end of Lindsay, and to point people towards Christ, to care for those who are our neighbors here, and to tell them about the hope that we have through Christ.
Now, you mentioned food security issues, mm-hmm. In the south end here. Has there been any other effect to the people of this neighborhood?
Yeah, it has been very difficult, especially when it comes to mental health and addictions. We've seen over the last year, ever since COVID, we've had more interaction with families that are broken because of addictions and mental illness. We've been two families in particular that we've really come alongside, and they both of they're single parent families, and the parent struggles with addiction, and the kids have been some cases the CAS has been involved, and it's been hard, and they're trying really hard, and yet this demon keeps coming back and pulling them down. Yeah. And so our people have been really good in helping out and trying to bless them and to support them and encourage them and show the grace of Christ. And this is something that for many of them, they, you know, when they mess up time and time again, they eventually get kicked to the curb and they say, no more, we're done with you. For us to continue to go back and say, we're still here because of Jesus, and we love you because of Jesus, not because of what you've done, not because of what you could be, but because of that you're made by God in His image, that He loves you, and because He loves you, we love you, and we will continue to walk with you and do the best that we can to share the love of Jesus Christ with you.
That's great. I love your heart for the neighborhood here. So as we close up, Mike, it has been good to be with you. Mm-hmm. But how can we, as a partner church, a sister church in the same Kawartha Association, how can we be praying for you and for your church?
Yeah, and I'm glad you asked this. Like, financially is wonderful, and I'm thankful for the financial support that Trentside has given over the years. But really, the prayer support is what we need desperately. Knowing that the body of Christ is praying for one another is huge. So one big thing that you could pray, be in prayer for us at the center is burnout. As we come alongside people who are broken, as we come alongside these families that are struggling, it's very easy for us to take on a lot of the weight. And that can burn, that can just really weigh us down. And even last fall, I was feeling just the effects of COVID, of doing ministry this way, and it was really getting to me. And so prayer for peace, for endurance, for wisdom and how best to proceed, discernment is huge. How we can best care for and love these people that God has brought into our midst. That's one thing. Second thing I would say is pray for others to come alongside and to care for the people in the neighborhood. We do have within the church, there's been a few families that have been really instrumental in caring for others, but there's more needs. And honestly, as we have other people come and join us, we can easily say, okay, can you help out here? And can you help out here? And this family needs this. And so there's needs there. The third thing would be, as we are proceeding forward, we've just got our charitable status, which is very cool. And we're going to be setting up some stuff, oversight and prayer for that, and just discernment how best to move forward and how best to be the church in a way that will use the tools, use the people that are here, and use them for God's glory.
We will definitely be praying for those things. And again, thank you for letting me come down and spend some time with you.
My pleasure. I'm glad that you could make it down.
Good morning, Trentside. So glad that you could join us again this week online. I have a few announcements for you today to be aware of. Our first announcement is a reminder of the survey that has been sent out to you in the Trentside Connect. We have had a number come in already, but would like a few more to come in. But we do need this done by this evening if possible. We so appreciate your help as you help us as staff and elders by filling these out. We are looking for your input regarding the future of our online services, and we will be continuing to provide online ministry, but we're praying through what that will look like as we proceed in the future. The next announcement this morning is about our Trentside Family Scavenger Hunt. We are hosting a scavenger hunt on Saturday, April 3rd from 10 to 12 noon. Families will be driving to various people's homes to find eggs which tell the Easter story. And I hear there might be chocolate. Families and kids registration for this event is open, and you can register on the church website or by the link in the Trentside Connect email. We also this morning want to let you know about our Easter services that are coming up. We're looking forward to Easter weekend. Registration is open for these services, and you can see that these services are happening on Good Friday at 8:30, 10, and 11:30 in Fenland, and 8:30 and 10 in Bobcaygeon. And then, as we look forward to Easter Sunday, we have three services at both of our sites, Fenland at 8:30, 10, and 11:30, and Bobcaygeon at 8:30, 9:45, and 11. We hope that you can join us for one of these Easter services on Good Friday and on Easter Sunday. We look forward to seeing you there. Let's come to our Lord together in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, you are our great God, and we thank you for the gift of prayer. We speak to you, our loving God, who created us and who offers us a relationship with you. May we be a praying church at all times, not just when things are tough, but we do ask now that you give us the wisdom in this pandemic as it continues. Give us wisdom how to reach others with the good news of your word. God, we thank you for each person that is watching this morning. We thank you that you are continuing your work here at Trentside. God, we also thank you for this day and the opportunity to worship you, to lift up your name in song and in word. I pray that we'd be able to be still and know that you are God. We pray that you would equip Pastor Jeff to proclaim your word to us this morning. Let us be attentive and eager to hear your truth, God. I pray that we would set aside whatever distractions or concerns we are carrying with us today, and let us listen and be changed. Let us ever more be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. We continue to pray for those in our congregation who are dealing with health concerns or healing from surgery, Lord. We also pray for the tithes and offerings that are given through this week. May they be used wisely to further your kingdom, Lord. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome, everyone. Please, pull up a chair, make yourself at home, and help yourself to whatever you see. We should never underestimate the power of sharing food. Whether it is a cup of coffee, a sandwich, a piece of pie, or even a good old-fashioned backyard barbecue. You may not realize this, but there is tremendous power in the act of sharing a meal. When we think of some of the great upending social changes that have taken place and revolutionized our planet, I'm sure we could think of a number of symbols of power, and of course, some of the people who have been responsible for these massive changes in history. Some of the symbols we might think of are perhaps a gun or some instrument of violence would probably be the first thing we think of. Well, obviously not a Nerf gun. Didn't think it would be wise to show a real one, not that I own one for our online service. But we probably think of weapons as something that can bring about or at least force societal change. Maybe we think of pen and paper. After all, the pen is mightier than the sword, where someone expresses their ideas and the aftermath of those ideas are enormous. Just think of the tremendous damage done in the last century from this short little book from Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. Or maybe it's just plain greed. Selfish desire has led to so many wars and the oppression of far too many people. However, let me suggest one more symbol. One of the most powerful symbols of societal change imaginable, and something far less intimidating. I'm talking about something as simple and as unthreatening as a plate of food. One of the most extraordinary ideas Jesus left us to consider is the power of a meal. Simply the importance of sitting together, two sets of people from different sides of the tracks, and sharing a meal together. The dinner table, believe it or not, is one of the most central aspects of Jesus' ministry. And no one highlights this more profusely and profoundly than Luke. Today, I want us to take a quick glance at how central table fellowship was to Jesus and how dramatically his simple action of sitting down and sharing food with others transformed our world, tearing down social boundaries in a huge way, as well as having us realize that our own tables are a microcosm of God's heavenly table. Today, a few friends have invited us into their homes and to their tables to share with us Jesus' table teachings. Enjoy and bon appetit.
Then Levi held a great banquet for Jesus at the house, and a large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating with them. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who belonged to the sect complained to his disciples, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and you say, "Here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners." Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume. When the Pharisees who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who was touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathered around to hear him, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled, "He has gone in to be a guest of a man who is a sinner."
One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of the prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or your relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. When one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the man who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God."
Then he said to him, "A certain man gave a great supper and invited many. Then the master of the house said to his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. Go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled.'"
Then Jesus told them this parable. But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older brother was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. The older brother became angry and refused to go in.
There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he looked up and he saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father, Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here and you are in agony."
There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and yourselves thrust out. They will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and sit down in the kingdom of God. And indeed, there are last who will be first, and there are first who will be last. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved.
Welcome back. And thank you, Sid and Renee, Ron and Judy, and Adriana and Yoka, for inviting us to your tables. If you got one thing from all those readings, I hope it is this. Jesus made a big deal on the importance of dinner parties. They were either used for inclusion or exclusion. And believe it or not, the most occurring picture of heaven in the Bible is not people sitting on clouds strumming their harps, but of a grand and glorious feast. Today, as we continue our series, Choosing Jesus, based on the Gospel of Luke, our focus will be on 3+ chapters from chapter 13 through 16, where Jesus concentrates his teachings around the importance of food and fellowship. This portion we want to highlight today is sometimes referred to as Jesus's table teachings. Obviously, I cannot give full justice, but I do want to highlight a couple of themes which I would then challenge you to go back over and read for yourselves. Check it out. But first, let's go back a little, and I want to point out an extremely important passage back in chapter 7, verse 34. We read this: "The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and you say, 'Here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.'" So why is this verse so essential for us to grasp? Well, here Jesus is speaking to the religious establishment. And this is at least the second time these religious people are castigating Jesus because of who he has chosen to associate with. As a result, they completely write Jesus off as being the Messiah or even a prophet, because if he really was a true servant of God, never in a million years would he associate with these dregs of society. Now, if you move down just a few verses to 39 in chapter 7, you'll see this again made explicit right from the mouth of a Pharisee who invited Jesus to dinner. Verse 39, we read these words. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." But instead of Jesus going, oh dear, you are so right. I need to be far more careful of who I associate with. I am so sorry for offending your delicate sensibilities. I will make sure from now on, I will completely exclude all troublesome people. Well, Jesus didn't say this. And not only does Jesus not do this, he actually doubles down and says the very fact I am welcoming in all these outsiders is one of the truest signs that I am Israel's Messiah, a true servant of God. And not only will I not stop, I am going to make it abundantly clear, you religious power brokers, you need to start doing the same. You need to start opening up your own homes and tables to all these outsiders. Now, let's look at how Jesus makes this message so crystal clear in the section we're calling Luke's table teachings. The first table teachings Jesus gives us is this, that God's table is one of generous inclusion, but also one of terrifying exclusion. Now, this is not just the theme here, but it's one that we will see as a recurring one. The section begins with a very important question being asked in Luke chapter 13, verse 23. Lord, are only a few people going to be saved? And Jesus answers with a pretty familiar refrain. He says, make every effort to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. But curiously, this is not where Jesus ends his comments. Jesus then goes on and he tells a short parable. This is from chapter verses 24 to 30. Of an owner who locks the door to his house and then after a certain time will no longer open it up to those anxious to get in. Then comes Jesus' peculiar ending, verses 28 to 29. Verse 28, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now this next part is so important for you to listen to. When you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourself thrown out. Now, I want you to remember that, especially that part about Abraham. Verse 29, people will come. They will come from east and west and north and south and will take their places at the feast in the kingdom of God. And verse 30, indeed, there are those who are last who will be first and first who will be last. Now, this is kind of confusing. This invitation that seems so narrow a second ago with warnings of making sure to act soon, otherwise you'll get locked out, now looks extremely broad, as if the door will be open to all sorts of people, or at least that there are all sorts of unexpected people who are already inside the party. So which is it? Actually, it's both. Generous inclusion and terrifying exclusion. Now, this is where everything that follows is super important for us to get. Immediately after this parable, there is a very emotional scene, verses 31 to 35 of chapter 13, where Jesus is weeping over Jerusalem because the people have rejected God's prophets and are still unwilling to change their ways. And what follows is Jesus pleading with the Jewish people, specifically the Jewish religious leadership, letting them know there is a great and glorious heavenly feast that they are all welcome guests to. But if they aren't careful, they will quickly lose their spot. And unbelievably to them, their spots will be filled by all these outsiders and outcasts. And from here, Jesus will point out their invitation to God's heavenly banquet is contingent on them beginning to open up their tables in a much broader fashion than they currently are. Now let's move a little bit further and consider how Jesus continues to make this abundantly clear. Table teaching too is this: we need to welcome uninvited guests. Note here how chapter 14 begins, and you will begin to realize why this chapter is referred to as the banquet chapter of the Bible. Verse 1 begins this way. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat at the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully Watch. Did you get that? Everything that follows is Jesus teaching about meals, and it all takes place during a meal. The first thing Jesus does is he brings up and he heals a man with dropsy. Now, dropsy is a disease of swelling of the joints. Now, this person, by definition, would be deemed unclean and defiled and would, based on tradition, defile the entire meal gathering. Now, some think this was probably a setup, a way to trap Jesus, where the leaders were actually trying to see if Jesus would go so far and touch an unclean person, both on the Sabbath and at a mealtime. It's a double taboo. And what does Jesus do? Shockingly, we read, taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him away, verse 4. Jesus actually welcomes him into their midst, and he does the unthinkable. He touches the man and heals him on the Sabbath and at a meal. Yikes! Now let's look what comes next. Table teaching number 3, invite the uninvited. Verses 12 to 15, we get this. After Jesus gives a little advice to the guests to stop trying to always grab the best spots, in verses 12 to 14, he gives some advice to his host. He says, hey, why not, when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, right? Try inviting the uninvitable. Now, after Jesus makes this statement, some smart aleck yells out in verse 15, blessed is the man who will eat at the kingdom of God. Now, this comment prompts Jesus to tell another table tale, calling this table teaching number 4. And it's this, that invitations can be revoked. And this story comes from verses 15 to 23 of chapter 14. In this parable, which I won't go into detail, Jesus is going to make even more clear what he has already been stressing to this point. The story begins with a wealthy man who holds this enormous banquet and invites all the important people of the town to his party. And sadly, they all decline. So he then sends out his servant into the streets and tells him to invite as many as he can. Listen to verse 21. Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Now, do you remember how this meal began? With Jesus welcoming and healing a cripple. So all these outcasts get welcomed, and Jesus ends by giving this warning. All the original invited guests lost their chance to attend. Too bad, so sad. Verse 14, verse 23, I tell you, not one of those men who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. Now, Jesus could have wrapped it up here, but he isn't done yet. And we will see this theme played out again and again. Jump ahead with me to chapter 15, and let's look at one of Jesus' most famous parables, the story of the prodigal son, and consider carefully how it begins. I'm calling this table teaching number 5, and it's just this, join the party for goodness sake. Listen to how it begins, chapter 16. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Egad, there it is again. Again, here are these religious snobs discounting Jesus. Why? Because of the company he is choosing to dine with, which then prompts Jesus to respond with yet another parable. Now, the parable is actually a 3-part parable. First, there is a person who loses a sheep, and he looks, he finds, and then throws a party. Secondly, there is a lady who loses some cash, and what does she do? She looks, she finds, and she also throws a party. Finally, there is a child who is lost, and the dad looks, the son is found, and again, a party is thrown. But how does the story end? There's an older brother who represents these religious snobs that Jesus is speaking to, and he becomes angry, and he refuses to go into this party. So the dad goes out pleading for the older brother to join the party. And the story ends in suspense. Will they acknowledge their outcast brother or not? And Jesus is subtly reminding them, people will rejoice for finding an animal and rejoice in finding some cash, but won't rejoice over an actual person who is infinitely more valuable. But we're still not done. Let's end by looking quickly at one last story, one more table teaching, which brings us back to right where we started, with outsiders in and the insiders out. Let's jump to Luke 16, verse 19. This table teaching I'm calling "Those Who Party Now May Not Party Later." The story begins this way. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day at his gate. Was laid a beggar named Lazarus, who was covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. So here we have a nameless rich guy with a desperate beggar who day in, day out, doesn't even get the table scraps from this rich creep. Then they both die. Now listen to verse 22. The time came when the beggar died and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and he was buried in Hades, where he was tormented. He looked up and saw Abraham from far away with Lazarus by his side. Now remember this, where is this poor beggar Lazarus? The beggar, we are told, is at Abraham's table, at Abraham's side. This is where an important reminder comes back in. Where did Jesus' table teachings begin? In verse 13, 28. Remember these words? There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourself thrown out. Do you get it? Another parable where the rich man, aka these Jewish elites, who do not act in time, and who are now watching this poor, unlikely soul who is now with Abraham, and they are on the outside looking in torment. Again, we should be reminded, people will come from east and west and north and south and will take their place at the feast in the kingdom of God. Indeed, there are those who are last who will be first, and the first who will be last. So here is the crux. What do we do with all of this? And there are two things that we really need to grasp. First, one of the greatest social revolutions Jesus gave the world was the way he understood the importance of a simple, everyday dinner table. Jesus knew the power in sharing a meal. A world greatly divided by class, by social strata, separated by the offenders and the offended, Jesus came and said, "No more. Everyone should get a spot at the table." In Luke, we see Jesus eating with the outcasts, the sinners, the sick, and he begs the upper crust to follow suit. And if you follow Luke's telling, we read in Acts, it is no longer rich and religious Jews eating with poor, sinful Jews. It is now Jews sharing their tables with defiled and unclean Gentiles. History radically changed over the simple act of sharing a meal. Now listen to Luke's beautiful description of the early church responding to Jesus' table teachings in Acts 2, verses 46 to 47. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. Beautiful. Second, as we saw with the first table teachings, God's table is one of generous inclusion, but also one of terrifying exclusion. God's table is far more generous than we could ever imagine, but there also seems to be a very strong catch. If God has so graciously invited us to a place at his banquet, then what right do we have to exclude others from ours? And it seems pretty clear. Those unwilling to open up their homes, their tables to others, will soon lose their spot at God's table. Now, when this COVID pandemic finally draws to a close and things really begin to open up again, many Christians are asking, when will the church open up, or at least to a much fuller extent? But for me, even more important than I desire to see church buildings open, I am far more interested in seeing the homes of the church opened up for each other, opened up for neighbors, and opened up for outsiders. Remember, for the first 300 years, the church never had buildings. All they had were homes. And our prayer is that we will all participate in this Jesus revolution in our own community, which will be best begin in our own homes and around our own tables. Will you pray with me? God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for this food. Amen. And cheers. Thanks so much for joining us once again for our Trentside online service. If you have need for prayer, have questions, or want to know how you can choose Jesus, please make sure you respond by contacting us. That information will be on the screen in just a moment. Until next week, will you join me in reading with me this benediction? Hospitable God, who invites us to your banquet, where the last may be first, and the humble and the mighty trade places. Let us share your abundance with no fear of scarcity. Let us greet strangers as angels, and let us serve all our guests with gracious hearts by making feel welcome all who gather, as though we are welcoming you, Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Amen, and have a blessed week.